Well, I'm very happy to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Richard Besser, well known to all of you, I am certain. His full bio is in your binder, and Rich has done a lot more in his life than I even knew when I read it through again last night. But in brief, as you all know, Rich is now the senior health and medical editor for ABC News after a long and very distinguished career at CDC and in medicine prior to that. He is very well known, nationally known, for having directed the first portion of CDC's response to H1N1 2009. Prior to that experience, he had many important positions at CDC over the years in various stations and has a great deal of experience from those different jobs. He's authored hundreds of articles, made countless presentations, and I had the opportunity to work with Rich a few moments here and there during the H1N1 response from a distance, and I can say that he was absolutely committed, tireless, fearless, and steady in the response, and he communicated with great skill to anxious audiences in America. And so we're all very grateful for that leadership that you exhibited during the response, and we're very glad and fortunate to have you today, Rich.
Thanks very much, Tom. It's a real pleasure to be here. Lots of familiar faces and some new ones. But I think it's so important to come together and share experiences and see what can be learned from the past year so that the next time there's a big public health crisis, the response will be even better. I want to tell stories. That's what I do now. I've changed hats. I've retired my PowerPoint, and I tend to tell a lot of stories. So I want to give my perspective on the response and the early part of the response, and then leave time for questions. My first engagement in this really starts before the pandemic. I wanted to just give a little bit on how I ended up in the position that I was in. I was in Israel the beginning of January as part of a Harvard School of Public Health Kennedy School study tour. There was a group of us who had gone over to try and learn from the Israelis. Why were they so good at emergency response? How did they organize? How did they engage the public? Why was the public in Israel so ready to step up and do what needed to be done during a crisis, yet in the United States, fewer than 10% of people had an emergency kit, had an emergency response plan? What could we learn from them? A couple hours after we arrived in Israel, the Israelis moved troops into Gaza. And so we were there during the early part of the Gaza war and were able to watch their decision making during a period of crisis. It was an incredible experience. So in the middle of this, I get a call from someone on the Obama transition team who says, if you were asked to be the acting director of CDC, what would you say? And I said, yes. I'd say yes. And they said, okay, we'll get back to you. And a couple days went on, and then I get another call, and they said, okay, you may get a call to be the acting director of CDC. If so, it would probably be for a few weeks until Senator Daschle is confirmed as secretary. But we want you to treat the job not like an acting job. We want you to just grab the bull by the horns and do what needs to be done. And a lot of things need to be done. And so I'm thinking, okay, this could be a fun month. And come back and got another call. I said, well, when do you think I might get this call? When do you think this could happen? And I was told, well, we don't know exactly, but stay tuned. So the inauguration happened on the Tuesday. Thursday, I'm in clinic. I'm a general pediatrician. I was doing an adolescent exam. And I get a phone call. And it's the Office of Personnel in HHS. And I said, yeah, they asked, is this Rich Besser? I said, yes. They said, you're now the acting director of the CDC. And I said, is there someone I can talk to about this? And they said, well, we'll get back to you. So the next day, it was a Friday, Mark Childress, who was the chief of staff in the department, called all the acting heads together. And there were a lot of us. We came up, and I had been preparing over the previous 2 weeks for this acting job. I'd read what to do during your first 100 days in government. And I'd reread Good to Great, which is one of my favorite leadership books. And so I was ready. I had my questions prepared that I wanted to ask Mark. So I, you know, after the meeting of the actings, he said, "Rich, glad you're here. I want to talk to you about." And I said, "Great, I want to talk to you too." And he said, "I want to talk to you about the salmonella and peanut butter outbreak." And I'm like, "Okay, we can talk about that. I want to talk to him about CDC." And so I had a couple minutes with him, and I said, "You know, Mark, what do you see at CDC? Do you see a need for stabilization? Do you see a need for minor change, or do you see a need for radical change?" And he said, "I see a need for radical change," which is not the one that I thought he would pick. And I said, "In what way?" And he said, "For too long, CDC has focused on low probability, high consequence events. You've been investing your money in preparedness and response, and you've not been dealing with those problems that really could impact, that those problems that really are impacting on health right now." And I said, "You know, Mark, you know, why in public health do we have to choose between the two? We have been getting increasing resources for preparedness and response, and we've seen a decline in our resources for things like diabetes and cancer and other health problems. And it's something in public health that we've had to deal with that I think is wrong. There should not be a trade-off between being prepared for the next pandemic or the next SARS outbreak or the next anthrax attack and being able to address those health problems that we face today." So that was that with my speech. I understood the marching orders and went back to Atlanta and spent a lot of time working on the Recovery Act and engaging and getting to know people across the executive branch. And then in April, it was late April, I had in place an acting leadership team, and Ann Schuchat, who's here, was part of that acting team. And one of the things that I delegated to her was the weekly pandemic flu preparedness meeting. This is something that Dr. Gerberding had put in place years before. Every Wednesday, leadership across the agency got together and went through where we were on being ready for a pandemic, where we were in terms of bird flu. And Ann said, "You know, I think you should come to the meeting on Wednesday. There are these two cases of swine flu from San Diego, and there's going to be a presentation on that, and that's something I think you really need to engage in." And so I went to the meeting, and by then there had also been a couple cases in Texas. And it became clear that there wasn't an obvious relationship between them. It wasn't just a cluster that was being detected, but it may have been something more. And we also talked about this unusual flu going on in Mexico, high mortality rate, and there was a concern that these might be related. So in this meeting, we decided to activate our Emergency Operations Center to help gather surveillance information around the country. Emergency operations centers are great for handling complex events, and so we activated the Emergency Operations Center. And by the next day, we had word through some back channels that Canada had identified the strain, that the strain in San Diego was the same strain as that was going on in Mexico. And so I put a call into to the department. And one of the interesting aspects, I think, of this pandemic was that it took place during a period of extreme political transition. We didn't yet have a Secretary of Health. Many of the departments either had new secretaries or may have had a secretary but didn't have the assistant secretaries or deputy secretaries in place. And so I sent a note up to Dora Hughes, who was my direct contact in the department, and said, "Dora, we really need a phone call tonight about swine flu, these cases we need to talk about." And she said, "Great, we'll do this conference call." And then a couple hours later, I got an email from someone else in the department who said, "We're kind of busy tonight. Let's do it tomorrow morning." And I sent back up and I said, "No. We need to have this conversation tonight. This is an important public health issue we need to talk about, and we think the White House may need to know. And so that night we had a conference call with the leadership up in the department. And one of the reasons that I was asked to be acting director was that for the previous 4 years, I've been directing CDC's emergency preparedness and response. And there was a recognition that during a period of transition, it's good to have people in place who already know the playbook, that they know how to work during a period of emergency and crisis. And up in the department, Admiral Vanderwagen was in place running the Office of the Assistant Secretary for Preparedness and Response, so he was engaged as well. So we had a call, we had the scientific leadership from CDC, we had the existing leadership team at HHS, and Laura Petru, who is the current Chief of Staff, she'd been on board, I think, a week. And I had never met her or had a conversation with her, and she said, you know, so I laid out what had been going on and what we knew, and she said, well, how concerned are you? On a scale of 1 to 10, how concerned are you that this could be the next pandemic? And I said, 8. And there was this like hush on the phone. And she said, 8? And I said, yeah, 8. It's a new strain. We don't think there's population immunity. It's spreading easily person to person. And we see something going on in Mexico that looks very, very bad. And that really kicked off the increased federal response to what was going on. We activated our Emergency Operations Center to its highest level. And by the next day, there was a lot of activity going on in Washington around this. I got off the phone, and Phil Navin, who was the director of the emergency operation at CDC, said to me, you know, 8? He said, I would have said a 6. Well, whatever. 8 got people's attention, and it got things moving. What I want to focus on is an aspect of the response that I think was somewhat novel, and I think was very important to the success of the government response, and that's communication. One of the things that we decided right away, it was the following day, was that we wanted to take control of the message around this developing pandemic. If there was a reporter who wanted an interview, we were going to give it. We were not going to turn down a single request for media, and we were going to do regular briefings to the press. And so I think the first one may have been done by the folks in flu, Nancy Cox and Dan Jernigan. Very quickly went to Ann Schuchat, who was head of the center, and then it went to me as the event was escalating. And then Ann and I traded off on this on a regular basis, and she continued it beautifully through the whole pandemic. But we laid out our strategy, and I want to go through some of the points, because we tried to reiterate those every time we did a press conference, every time we talked to people within government. We said that influenza containment was not possible. You know, we'd been planning around bird flu. Bird flu, we decided, was going to start probably in Indonesia. That would be convenient, hopefully a remote location. We'd get a team out there. We'd bring a lot of antivirals. We'd be either able to slow its spread, so we'd have a few weeks to gear things up here, or maybe we'd be able to quench it if we got really, really lucky. This bug did not read the playbook, and so by the time it was recognized, it was already within our borders, and so influenza containment was not possible. There was a lot of discussion around that early on. People were saying, why not close the border? And so we had to communicate around why that wasn't a good use of resources. We decided that we were going to direct our actions towards mitigating the impact on people's health, that was number one. We were going to take aggressive action until we knew that less aggressive action would be okay. And so at this point, without knowing how severe a pandemic strain this was, we were going to do a very aggressive steps. We'd share what we knew, when we knew it, with the public and the broad international community. And so we were not going to hold back. If we had partial information, we were going to share that partial information. Our actions would be based on the best science available. And we wanted people to realize that we were going to be undertaking steps to further that science, but that early on there was going to be a lot of uncertainty and the picture would be changing. We were going to direct our resources at those things that were likeliest to have the biggest impact. And you know, there's so many things you can do, some of which may have impact but be very expensive. We were going to direct our labor at those things we thought were the most prudent. And that, when it came into the whole border closure issue, was a very important principle. We talked about whether we should send teams out, limit the number of airports that people could come in, and do screening. And it just, it was very apparent to us that that was very labor intensive, very expensive, and not a good use of resources. We let people know that different things would take place around the country and that this was a good thing. You want different things to take place so you can learn, so you can develop guidelines. You can see New York was doing something very different than was going on in Texas, that was going on in California. And that was something that would be expected, and we hope to be able to learn from that. We let people know that we were going to change our guidance as we knew more, and that at times they would find conflicting guidance on the web. And that when they found that, we wanted to know about it so that we could fix it. And then one of our primary principles was that this was a shared responsibility. It wasn't something the government did for people. Government had a role. Communities had a role. Churches, schools had roles. Families had roles, and individuals had roles. And we talked about that shared responsibility to try and get everyone engaged in this as part of a national effort. I think that communications is underappreciated in public health and in government as a tool. You could do everything right in the response to the pandemic, but if you haven't gained the trust of the public, you failed. Likewise, you can do everything right in responding to an emergency, and if you haven't gained the trust of the political layer, you've failed. And communication is important in terms of developing that trust. We used repetition. We started every press conference the same way, going over the principles. You can't assume that people have heard them just because you did them the day before. And even if they've heard them, you can't assume that they've really internalized them. We let people know that it was a rapidly changing situation, there was uncertainty, and aggressive action was going to be warranted. And then we used foreshadowing. There were times when we knew what we wanted to do in a few days, or what we were likely going to be doing. And we used our press briefings as a way to get that word out. And I'll go through an example where that was very important. There were a number of critical decisions that were made early on. And one of the toughest, and one of the ones where I think the principles came out very clearly, was around school closure. CDC had done a lot of work around bird flu, looking at things called community mitigation measures, non-pharmaceutical interventions. And the level of interventions that you do, the level of social distancing you do, is dependent on how severe a pandemic strain you think it is. Unfortunately, early on, there's a lot of uncertainty around that. And so we made efforts to apply the principles that had been very well vetted. And these, the one around school closure is an obvious one. There was a big school outbreak in New York. We were concerned about children being a way of spreading flu within the community, as well as children being likely victims of this flu. And so we worked on drafting guidelines for this pandemic. And the initial guidance was that if you have a confirmed or suspected case of flu in your school, you would shut your school down until you were able to investigate this further. And that guidance was developed and was put on the web. And this was totally consistent with being aggressive. It was totally consistent with the pandemic community mitigation guidelines. Well, around this time, I was asked to come to the White House to brief the president and the cabinet on what we were doing. And we had posted our guidance several days before, and then we had done a revision of the guidance. And the revision of the guidance was to try and deal with the issue of how long do you close schools for? You've closed it, when can you reopen? Well, the team at CDC looked at this, they looked at the evidence, they looked at viral shedding, and came up with a recommendation that schools be closed for 2 weeks. And this has to do with how long you could be shedding and really wanting to make sure that you're quenching this. And we vetted this within the agency, and we went up to the department, and we got this up on the web, and it was a Friday. And I'm there, and I'm briefing the cabinet, and that's another story. Well, no, actually, it's an important story, so I'll just tell that story. So I got a call on a Thursday that the following day I was to come to the White House and brief the president and the cabinet, and that I should meet at the department that morning with the Secretary of Health, who'd been on the job for 3 days, and we would go to the White House and do this briefing. And so I got to the department, and we're in Secretary Sabiris's office, and I say, you know, can I get some guidance from anyone here? How do you brief the president and the cabinet? And they look at me and it's, no idea. I said, okay, well, how long should I talk for? And they said, 7 minutes, you know, 5 to 7 minutes, something like that. So we go to the White House and we're in the cabinet room, and I do the briefing. Basically, I just do a variation on the press briefing that I've been doing every day. And it ends, and the president asks some questions, and then Secretary Clinton asks a question. She said, you know, Dr. Besser, how is the swine flu different from seasonal flu? And it just totally relaxed me, because it became clear to me right there that the cabinet was no different from the general public. It's true. This was not a group of experts in flu. You couldn't expect them to be. They were like the general public, and their questions and their concerns were a really good reflection on the general public. Sitting across from the president was the vice president. And the vice president, a couple days before, had been up at a podium and someone had asked him whether it was safe to get on an airplane. And he said something along the lines of, you know, I'm not getting on a plane, I'm telling my family not to get on a plane. Not a good idea. And so I got a call in Atlanta saying, we need you to go on the air for the noon shows. And I quickly got on the air, and I think it was MSNBC, and they said, you know, the vice president said people shouldn't fly. What do you think? I said, well, you know, this is a teachable moment. What the vice president meant was, you know, his concerns are what can you do to protect your health? And his concerns are for his family. And it's clear that if you have the flu or you have flu-like symptoms, you shouldn't fly. And that is what the vice president was trying to get at. But if you don't have the flu, it's perfectly safe to fly. And people should feel very comfortable moving about. And so, looking around the cabinet, it was an opportunity to really educate people at the level that they were. And it, I think, for me, was an important lesson of you don't expect that the political leadership is also the technical leadership. You have to deal with that leadership in a different way. So the meeting ended, and I was called into Rahm Emanuel's office. And they said, all right, we got to talk about this school closure guidance. In the room was Secretary Duncan and Napolitano and Sebelius and Rahm Emanuel and David Axelrod, and they were not happy with this guidance. I could pick that up. And I said, you know, what's the problem? They said, well, the Department of Education wasn't engaged enough in this. The mandate of the Department of Education is to keep children in the seat learning for as many days as possible. And you just put out a guidance that says that they should be closed for 2 weeks when there's the first case of flu. That's not going to fly. And Rahm Emanuel's at the end of the table. He says, all right, I'll fix this. So he pulls out a pad and he starts writing guidance. And all through the cabinet meeting, the president had said, everything we do will be based on the best available science. And so I'm in this room, there's Rahm Emanuel, who is a talented individual, but he's not a scientist. He's writing guidance down the end. I lean over to Secretary Sebelius and I said, I'm not very comfortable with this. And she says, you know, just relax. And so Rahm is writing and he reads what he has, and David Axelrod says, you know, Rahm, I don't think it's a good idea that you're writing this guidance. And so Rahm crumbles up the guidance, throws it in the corner, and goes back to eating his lunch. And the secretary and I go off to a call with all of the governors. And a couple minutes later, well, it was probably 15 minutes later because we were in the middle of the call, the deputy communication director comes in and says, you know, Rich, I want you to read this revision to the guidance. And I want to know is it consistent with the science? And I looked, and they just made a couple changes. They had said that instead of where it had said we'll be closed for 2 weeks, they said in a week we will reassess the situation and determine how long schools will be closed. And I said, yeah, this is consistent. I said, we expect over the weekend, over the next few days, to have more information about Mexico. If we find that the situation is different there, our recommendations may change. And so the guidance changed. And what it indicated to me is that science is very important. There are certain decisions and guidances and policies that are pure science. How long do you treat someone who has the flu? That's not a policy decision. That's a science decision. How effective is a vaccine? Do you need one dose or two? Well, that is primarily a science decision. But a decision to close schools is a policy decision that's informed by science. And it's very important that those of us who are technical experts understand that interface and why it is so critical. The following day, the president got on the air as his radio address and talked to people about the flu and about the shared responsibility. And he had taken the messages that we'd developed at CDC and was really running with them and talked about school closure and why that was so important. Well, a part of my communication strategy, or the agency communication strategy at this point, was to engage with opinion leaders very actively. And so in addition to the media briefings, I was on the phone pretty much every day with thought leaders, some of whom are in the room. I remember that Saturday, I was at my son's soccer game because I talked to people at CDC about taking a day off, so this was my day off. And I was on the phone with some opinion leaders, and they were all saying the same thing, that the school closure guidance was nuts. I heard from public health leaders around the country, state and local level, they said it's not working. Parents are dropping their kids off at the mall. They're dropping them off at community centers. You want to do social distancing, it's not working. The government hasn't put in place any policies to support people who want to stay home from work to take care of their kids. They're going to lose their jobs. It just is not working. At the same point, I'm hearing from the folks in the Emergency Operations Center, the flu team, that they've got a lot more data from Mexico. There's a lot of widespread flu. It doesn't look like it's that different from what we're seeing in the U.S. There's widespread disease around the country. And the mortality rate, we think, is a lot lower than we initially suspected. So this is great. And they said, we recommend that schools not be closed that long, that they could, that we don't need to do this aggressive school closure. And so I call up to Laura Petru and say, good news, we don't have to do the school closure. We're ready to revise the policy and have a very different approach, a very limited school closure. And she calls the White House, and we have a conference call with the folks there, and they say, are you nuts? I said, just yesterday you told the schools had to be closed 2 weeks. Today the president went on the radio and told Americans to be ready for this sacrifice. They said, we want to see more data. We want to see a few more days of data and more information out of Mexico before we're willing to make a policy change that's that radical. They said, if you take the American public from here to over here in a day, you're going to lose their trust, and they're not going to follow anything else that you want them to do. And I thought it was a very good example of how policy and technical need to interface. And so what we did in our press briefings for the next 2 days was foreshadow, that we're looking at data, we're seeing encouraging data out of Mexico. If it continues, we think we're going to be able to back off on some of the school closure. I talked to folks at state health departments. Some of them were already changing their policies, but they were getting a sense that we weren't going to throw them under the bus if they were not closing their schools in the way that we had as our guidance. That's pretty much what I want to say. You know, in terms of moving forward, I think that one of the lessons from this pandemic is the importance of communication. I think that after I left CDC, they did an absolutely brilliant job of communicating. And the analyses of what the public was seeing in the media, the analyses that came through the Harvard polling data that Bob Blendon provided that let CDC know what the public was thinking, what they were doing, where some of the gaps were, I thought were really important. I think that there's more that can be done. Through my years at CDC, we kind of had this love-hate relationship, love-hate-fear relationship with the media. Now I'm on the other side of that. And it's a very interesting perspective. But I think that the more we train public health professionals and others in government about the value of the media and what the media can do in terms of affecting public perception, and by doing that affecting public behavior, the more effective we're going to be. It takes an investment. I remember during the pandemic, we were getting polling data every 3 to 4 weeks, when in reality you need data that's like the Nielsen's. You need data that's, you know, every few days so that you can stay on top of what's going on. I think that speed is important, and having technical people in high levels who can drive decision making is important. You know, it was interesting. During the early days of the pandemic, there was an ambassador who came to visit, and we were sitting around the conference room in the director's office at CDC, and he said, you know, what do you, you know, things looked like they were going really well. What do you attribute this success to? And I said, well, you know, I think that one of the most important factors was that there was no political leadership. There was no secretary. And he said, you know, I don't think I'd lead with that. And then I went on to explain, you know, that it was very, it made decision making very easy in those early days. It became very apparent why political leadership was so important in the response. But the balance of those, of how do you get the technical decisions to really inform what you're doing, and how do you get the political leadership engaged to make sure you're making the right policy decisions. That's what people elect people for. That's a real challenge, and one that I think isn't talked about enough. In all of the leadership training I went to, we talked about how to lead our organizations and how to lead up and across, but how do you engage effectively with political leadership who may be changing very quickly, who have their own agendas, is an area that I think needs to be looked at more. So, you know, moving forward, don't look to the media as your friends. We're not your friends. Look to the media, though, as I think a very powerful way of affecting the course of an event. And if you do that and you understand what drives the media, I think that it will really improve the response. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Rich, for that. That was very forthright and very useful, and probably new for many of us. We have a few minutes for questions. I have a few cards, and I'll encourage you to bring up other cards, or if you really want to use the mic, that's fine too. First, the last thing you said was, we're not your friends in the media. Would you just say a little more about that?
The media has a very important role in terms of checks and balances. And so it's not a friendship role. It's you know, as now a member of the media, I don't see my role as being out to get anybody. But it's also not to be the public spokesperson for the government. Mm-hmm. And so if I see something that I think isn't going right, it's part of my job to report on that. On the other hand, one of the reasons I went to ABC News was I think it's a way that I can be very impactful in terms of people's health here and around the world. And so understanding what type of stories we're looking to do can turn the media into a very important ally.
Question?
Yes, Daniel Miller from HHS International Flu Unit. Dr. Besser, if you could comment a little about those early days in terms of communications and coordinating your communications with our global partners.
Yeah, you know, I didn't go through all the arms of the communication strategy. The global communications was very important. I was in contact very regularly with Margaret Chan at WHO, every day with David Butler-Jones up in Canada. And less frequently with folks in Mexico because they were harder to get on the phone, but we had a scheduled daily call. And those were very important. As we worked on those early days, we wanted to make sure that the efforts in Mexico were tri-national at a minimum. There was efforts that were going on there were Canadian, US, and Mexico, and then there was the WHO efforts that CDC participated in as well. A couple other pieces of the, I think, it was communication strategy, but it was also external engagement. There was the Team B process that brought in experts, I think you were part of that, brought in experts from around the country to critique what we were doing so that in real time we could get feedback as to what we might be missing. And that was also a very important part. Now, I think it is part of communication because each of the people who were part of that group had a very detailed understanding of the response and were able to talk about that. And many of the people who were part of that group were people that the media would turn to with questions because they were leading experts. And that was a way of amplifying the message.
I have a question here asking, what was the most difficult thing about working with political leadership? What's the most difficult thing to translate?
Yeah, I think on a national level, scientific literacy is extremely low. I didn't find that to be the case with the political people I was dealing with. They were pretty quick studies. But during a period of transition, a lot of people are very hesitant to make decisions. And at CDC, we weren't. CDC only has one political appointee, and that's the director. So as an agency, it's pretty nimble about moving forward. It can make decisions in a way that the office of the secretary in Washington can't, because up there, there's a lot of political leadership. So I think that was, it provided an opportunity for us because we were willing to come down pretty hard on what our recommendations were, and political leaders were not not likely to challenge that very much at that point.
What is the most surprising thing you've learned now that you're on the other side of the microphone?
There's a lot of surprising things. I tell people I feel like a foreign exchange student. Trying to learn the language and the customs and the culture and how to engage. A number of things. I'm struck by how smart the people are I'm working with. Something I didn't fully recognize when I was on the other side. Very smart. They know though what makes good television. And so I came in with lists and pages of story ideas. That put just about everybody at ABC News to sleep. And so learning to see how do you take an important health issue and develop it into a story. So how do you find a character? How do you find a narrative arc? How do you find a hero? And how do you tell that in a minute and 30 seconds? It can be done, but it's very challenging. And the folks that I'm encountering at ABC News are very good at doing that.
Hi, my name is Fred Guttrell from Newsweek, and I am your friend.
Sure you are. Yeah.
Just kidding. I'm curious to know how health authorities in this country found out that there was a new. An outbreak happening in Mexico. It seems like a lot of people got sick, and I just wonder, did the authorities in Mexico know? Did they call the CDC? How was it reported? How did it come to light?
That's not something that I'm the best to answer. I know that there've been work going on. There've been contacts between. CDC and folks in Mexico looking for the usual pathogens to try and provide assistance. I think there have been contacts as well at the Office of the Secretary, the Office of Global Health Affairs. So there was a lot of back and forth there around that. The Mexican authorities were well aware of this. and had already taken steps to try and control this even before they knew what the pathogen was. The identification of the pathogen was done almost simultaneously in Canada and the U.S. by sharing of specimens. And that's a pretty typical thing, to share specimens back and forth between countries.
But that didn't happen until pretty late, right? March?
I don't know the timeline for what samples were done earlier. I think that until there was the realization that there was this new strain of flu, I don't know what had been looked for in terms of influenza before that.
So, Rich, from the media's perspective, how could public health leadership have better managed public expectations about the vaccine shortage in particular? Is there something we could have done differently?
You know, that was the one communication thing that I didn't think went very well. I think that there was, it was an example of overpromising and underdelivering. And it wasn't due to anyone's bad efforts. It was good faith based on what the estimates were from manufacturers and what the expected growth was. But had the CDC and the department said that vaccine would be available in December, and then some vaccines started to flow before then, it would have been a very different perception of the shortage. It wouldn't have been a shortage. It would have been, it's earlier than expected. And flu is, as Tom Friedman was saying, flu is very unpredictable, and vaccine is unpredictable. And over the years, there have been problems with production from time to time. And so I think that was the only thing that I saw that on a communication side that was a problem. And it came. Then there was the swing from as Tom said, bouncing across the guardrails. This went from being the worst thing ever to being something that no one needs to worry about and the government had overreacted to. And that's a challenge, but I think the government should always be willing to just accept that. You know, if you're not aggressive early on and it's bad, it's too late. And so, you're going to have responses that are above and beyond what was needed, but you're not going to know that until it's retrospective.
How much were international perceptions factored into the policy making, especially at the beginning? The perceptions of what other countries thought of what we were doing?
That was not a big factor at all. I mean, we were watching what was going on in Geneva and their decisions around, is this a pandemic? And one of the points we kept making is, it is for us. It didn't really matter what WHO called it. We were going to respond based on what we were seeing. And just like New York saw something very different early on than Chicago, pandemics are a series of local events. And so in the U.S., this was basically a pandemic. It was an epidemic, and it didn't really matter. And so a lot of the messages were, we don't know when WHO is going to declare this a pandemic. They probably will, and it's not going to change a single thing we do. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, was helpful at diffusing some of the anxiety around that word.
And I have one last question, which is there anything in particular in terms of CDC policy or health policy or decisions that now looking back at the beginning you think maybe we should rethink? So, for example, you talked about the idea of maybe we could contain H5N1 in Southeast Asia if we get in there fast. And some people think that that's unlikely. But are there things that you learned along the way that you thought, next time around, let's not do that?
I think that it's really important that this trade-off that is talked about all the time between preparedness and being able to take care of the current health problems, that we don't get hung up on that. And you see it within the public health community where, chronic disease people are saying, we need to move money out of preparedness and move it into chronic diseases. I think public health has to be all on the same page that you need to be able to do both. Because as soon as you start into that discussion, you are assuming it's a fixed pie. And it's absolutely clear that as a nation we invest far too little in prevention. And so getting some of the the healthcare dollars that are non-prevention or the budgetary dollars that are not related to health shifted in so you can do both is really key. And had this pandemic not occurred, I think that the budget that went forward would have had a lot less money in there for ongoing prevention efforts. And at the state and local public health level, that would just be disastrous for whatever the next event will be.
So on that good, strong advocacy note for public health, we'll let you go. We thank you for joining us. We wish you the best of luck in ABC News, and thanks so much for joining us, Rich.